Before we begin today's program, may I request all of you to put your phones on silent mode, please. Thank you very much, parents. Now we have the traditional and auspicious lamp lighting ceremony as a tribute to the goddess of knowledge, Saraswati. May I now request our
Good morning to one and all present here. I think most of the queries which Lakshmi has put forward, I will be covering it up, but post that there will be a question answer session, so parents still having something to ask can put forward their queries. Dear parents, today, this 28th day of March 2015, I welcome you all to be working as a team on board the flight towards your, or shall I say, our children's future. We are all familiar with Khalil Gibran's verse on children. Your children are not your children. their life's longing for itself. And it goes on to state that though your kids come through you, they belong not to you, and that we can house their bodies, not their souls. Many parents try to manifest their own unfulfilled dreams and desires through their kids, not realizing that children come into this world with their own dreams and agendas. I attended a very interesting course on metaphysics some time back, where it was stated that every parent's duty is to nurture their children. You put them on this planet, hence it's your obligation and duty to protect them. Protect them from housing ill feelings towards fellow beings, elders, and all living things. Nurture them to appreciate the beauty of life and beautify that which is not. We are all parents, yes? So all of us have faced similar situations in our life, gone through certain jittering stages when our children have not responded to us, when we've tried to talk to them. There have been stages when the children are showing a different behavior totally at home, and when they come to school, there is a totally different behavior. We generally feel that there is something called an individual behavior and there is something called a classroom behavior. We as teachers observe something different, you as parents might be observing something different. So here we are trying to bridge that gap as to how we can facilitate that the children become comfortable when they make a transition from a pre-primary school to a primary school. Before we begin that, I'd like to share certain principles. We say these are the 10 principles of parenting, where we can take these tips to look forward to a holistic development of an individual. In today's world, it's not that my child gets these many marks or he's a scholarship holder or anything. What we look forward to is a holistically developed individual who tomorrow is able to adapt to the demanding needs of the society and work together more in a collaborative way rather than an individual way. So today, I think most of us who are working, if you look at whether it's a school or a company or an MNC or a BPO, it's more about collaborative working. But a stage comes when generally, nowadays, most of the parents are either single parents or some of them, I stand corrected, some of them are single parents and some of them are having only one child in the family. How many of us are having like that? Just one child so far? So, many of us. What happens then is that whether the child has learned how to share, how to care, how to work together in a team, any company today which has gone on to do successfully well, or any school, for that matter, you would have seen since morning, those who came in early would have seen my team running around. You know, myself alone is not the word today. It is we, ourselves together. So that is where it steps in, that how do we make our children grow up in a society and meet the demands of the society. The first and the best example is being role models to them. Role model doesn't mean we say something and we do something else. You know, generally smaller children look up to their adults, their teachers or parents to follow what they do. So whatever we do, they imitate it. Initially, the child imitates out of habit. When you see that when the child is growing up in the initial stage, they imitate out of habit. Whatever mama does or elder brother does or elder sister does, they copy. But slowly over a period of time, the child's mind starts developing and they are able to understand what the parent is doing. So when we say be a role model, we cannot just preach the children. We have to set certain examples by following it ourselves. Today, in all our busy lifestyles, somewhere we are missing the connect with the children. At least when the children come to us, we realize that in order to meet the demands of the society or the today's lifestyle, most of the parents are working parents. I think most of us will be having where the mother and the father also goes for work. So what happens in the schools, the child needs to go home and relate. When we say, be involved, do not ignore. Can I have a participant? When we say be involved, sometimes there are things which keep happening in the school and children eagerly run home and try to share it with the parents. You know, they would like to narrate whatever has happened in school. Small things which causes a remarkable impression on their mind, but at times when parents are working, they are not able to immediately talk to the child. So they miss out on these small milestones in their life. You know, initially, when we start in a new school, there will be so many things that the child would be wanting to go home and share. It's all about giving them that quality time. When we say quality time, it's been my experience so far, parents think that once a year, you book a Euro tour and take your child off from school and go out for 15 days, that's quality time. I don't think we agree to it. How many of you agree to this? Most of you don't. I like that. Quality time is even just spending half an hour daily with your child in the evenings. You know, sometimes you just sit and listen to them. They need somebody who's ready to listen to them, whatever they want to say. This is the stage where they will be ready to communicate. Over a period of time, they will grow up, they will go to the colleges, they'll have their own circle of friends, and then they will not need this kind of communication. And you will look back and miss this time that my child was talking to me earlier, now they don't share. So initial stages, this is the most important thing. I have children in my school in class one, in the afternoons or in the morning, they'll say, I don't want to go home. When we speak to these children, a couple of them, what happened, why do you don't want to go home? My mommy comes back late in the evening. When I go home, there is only a mossy at home. I don't have anybody to talk to. So I want to stay here and talk to my Almas miss or Vijayta miss, somebody or other. They just want to share things. So that is when we say quality time. Give your child that support that if I go home and discuss things with my parents, there are people who are ready to listen to me. There's somebody who's there at home waiting eagerly to see what's happened. Just helping them in homework, that's not your duty. Anyway, homework, I have seen parents, I have an extreme end where parents do the homework. The homework is a tool for the teacher to assess whether the child has learned something or not. It is not just sitting with the child, making him do the homework or doing his homework. That is not parenting. The homework will automatically fall into place once the child is happy. Our aim is, let the child come to school looking forward to it, you know, let the child be. There is one statement there, point number 9, which we strongly support. When we say, is your child happy coming to school? Does he look forward to? That means he's been given that much of looking forward to what event, what is happening, what activities are happening that they want to come to school. Same way, we are not there to live their life. We are there to make a path for them to follow. So, when we talk about establishing rules, beta, aapne ye nahi karna hai, TV nahi dekhna hai, but 9 baje nahi, aap apna TV on karenge and you sit in your room to watch a serial. That is not what is establishing and setting rules. Rules for ourselves and for our children. When I tell my children in my school, better try to communicate in English, at the same end, it is mandatory for all my staff to speak in English. Or when it's a Hindi period, we tell the children, it is mandatory to speak in Hindi. So when we set the rules, it's a finger, it's pointing both ways. It is not one-way road. It's a two-way traffic. Same way when we set certain rules for the children, it is for us to follow them also. This is like addiction, you know, multimedia. Something which impair, mummy is busy cooking in the kitchen, beta iPad pada hai, ab game khel lijiye. You know, just trying to keep them busy. Or parents have something important to do, come home, switch on the channel you like, you watch whatever you want. That is something. Anyway, today the exposure to the multimedia is very high. Children are picking up things which they are not supposed to be picking up at the tender age of 7 and 8. We have certain children in our school, around 6, 7, they are talking about things which at least 5 years back was a topic of discussion for teenagers. It's gone down to that extent. And when we talk to the children and ask, how did you come to know about it? I switched on the TV today morning after going home. There was nobody at home. I switched on the TV. This was the thing on the screen and the channel. That means something the parents might have watched yesterday evening, night, late night, and there is no child lock. The channel is very much open. The child goes home in the evening after school and it's there for him to know. So the awareness is much more. The IQ levels from our end is very, very high. A 4-year-old, 5-year-old, how many of your children can operate all your mobile apps? See, that is what we say. It's the awareness, this generation, when we talk about IQ, their aptitude and IQs are very high. But how we channelize is going to make a big difference. That is where the parents and the teachers need to work collaboratively. The sensitivity to understand that if a child is using certain things which he is not supposed to be doing at that age, we need to look back, where have we gone wrong? A child is a child. It's a clay which we are going to mold according to what is expected. So if the molding is proper, definitely they'll go on to be, you know, very established individuals in the world tomorrow. Most of us today, it's very sad, you know, when you read newspapers, children losing patience, not having that ability to just teacher in kuch keh diya. It's very rampant. I think you might have been reading newspapers. A child was scolded or he was caught cheating in the examination. The teacher just scolded and said, why did you do it or something? The child immediately jumped out of the window in the house in the evening. This was there in the newspaper recently. So these incidents, what happens is, at times we become too harsh on the children, forgetting that where will they let out this kind of frustration? If anything has happened, any untoward incident has happened, we need to sit and talk to the children. We need to counsel them. We need to, that is the reason the role of counselors has come in a big way. And in our school, I'm proud to say that we have full-time counselors who help us in talking to the children. The approach is totally child-oriented. We first need to see what is the reason. So we have to be firm, but not harsh to the children. When we say firm, it's time to study. Yes, it is time to study. You need to switch off the TV. And then when it is time to play, you need to play. It's not that you can be just sitting in front of the TV. But that doesn't mean, okay, last time you participated in this sports day, annual function, you need not participate. We have such an incident recently in our annual function. One of the babies in class one afternoon, you know, she was getting restless in the class when we were practicing for annual day. We spoke to the child and we asked, what is it, beta? Why do you keep running? Mujhe ghar jana. Every time she used to say evenings, I want to go home. We just spoke to the child. She says, I want to dance and participate, but mama ne bola hai, nahi karna hai. And we just spoke to the parent, what is your reservation, why you are not? She said, no, I am not able to, you know, pick up the child on a particular time if you are calling for rehearsals. So we said, okay, we take up the responsibility. You just allow your child. There was a remarkable change in the behavior of the child within 2 days. The next day, and within three, this was just 3 days before the annual function. Can you imagine a 6-year-old child, within 3 days she picked up the dance steps, she went on to perform on the stage, and the pleasure which we could see in the child on the performance was really remarkable. So when we say be firm, we are expecting that the cooperation, we need to understand where to draw the line. You know, where do we say, okay, ye nahi karna hai aur ye karna hai. Again, it's almost like when we say be role models, we need to follow them first. We have to set examples. The moment we start speaking, I think some of you might be saying, okay, she's lecturing or something, you know, good parenting. It's not lecturing. It's just sharing our thoughts with you so that the transition for your child coming into the CBSE becomes much more easier and a happier experience for all of us. So when we say set examples, we prefer to do it, and then since they are going to imitate us, follow us, children will say, "Meri teacher ne ye kaha hai, meri mummy ne ye kaha hai. My mom says this, my father says this, so my teacher says this." And at times, it is always, "My teacher is always right." Yes? Whatever the parent might try to say, "Nahin, this might be wrong, beta, isne galti se tick laga diya hoga." No, my missus said it. So it's not that she said it. They look up to the teacher as a role model. So the responsibility there, at the same time when the child comes spending, you know, quality time with the parents, 8 hours or 10 hours at home, they bring those images as well in their mind. So when they say, "My mom has said this," definitely what mom and papa says is always right. They need to, you know, understand that whatever the parents are advising, it is. So we do not advise them or give them this verbal lectures. We just follow and do what we expect them to do. I already think I have told you about quality time. It's not about going out on trips, taking break from school, sending an application to the principal. "Okay, I'm traveling for 3 weeks with my children on a Euro trip." It's mandatory to have 80% attendance in school. And the learning also for that period goes missing. So quality time means just giving them the time when they would like to sit and talk to you. Every day, half an hour, 20 minutes, or whatever you can spare, you know, while traveling to school, picking the child, going home. Some time when you have, you've kept everything aside. You know, you'll be doing some work and you'll go on nodding, "Haan bache, maine sun liya, haan bache, maine sun liya." When the child will say, "You didn't even pay attention to what I was talking about." So that is what is quality time. We should have that feeling that the child can go back and talk to somebody at home. Same way, he should be able to come communicate in the class as well to the teachers. This is another thing which has spread widely nowadays. That child goes for judo classes, this child goes for karate classes, my child needs to go the same way. He goes for a practice class. It is not that the learning is not going to happen in school. Everything happens in school. Just to keep the child engaged, busy, ke chalo wahan jayega, I will be able to finish my work. This has become like hordes of children going for certain classes. We need to understand what are the talents of our children. Individuals are alike. No 5 fingers are alike. How can the children be alike? Just because child A goes for abacus does not mean child B also has an interest in maths and he needs to go for an abacus class. He might be good at music. He might be good at dancing. So we do not standardize things, neither in the school. I have a heterogeneous classroom with all kinds of children, all kinds of learners together. So I need to use different tools to keep them engaged, even when we do assessments or anything, to cater to all their demands. Unless that happens, their attention will be lost in the class and they will not be interested in what's happening in school. Same is the way at home. We need to understand what are the talents, the inborn talents of the child, and then put them onto that kind of interest rather than standardizing them and saying that these particular set of children need to go. That's a very good quote. "Children close their ears to advice but open their eyes to examples." Now we come to what is holistic development when we've been talking about all this time. How does the school contribute to that holistic development? The NCF, National Curriculum Framework, established by CBSE in 2005, they brought in a program called CCE. I know there have been different interpretations. In 2009, it was brought in the month of October, mid-semester it was brought in. It's called as the Continuous Comprehensive Evaluation. If you understand each word, it's very clear that it is not towards the end of the road learning. It is during the course of learning. Continuous, comprehensive evaluation. That is, when the child is sitting in the class for these 160 or 200 working days, What is the learning happening? Assessments, evaluation throughout the academic year. In our times, in most of your times as well, you study, exams come, you write the exam, results come. So even if 1 month before the school or exam you study, results are there. But today it's not like that. It is a learning process which is going to happen throughout the year, and the assessments or whatever is going to happen, we are going to go on assessing. So the aim for this is holistic development. How? In our times or in your times, academics was the be end of all. Number achhe aage, that's it. Nobody is bothered whether you know how to sing. Nobody is bothered whether you know how to, whether any of us are, you know, good speakers, whether any of us know how to work in a team. It's individual assessment, pen paper examinations, which all of us have written, and it's something like 10th board exam, 12th board exam, with that it gets closed. It's no longer so. Since 2009, the CCE which has come in, it is being broken down into terms, semesters like colleges. The reason is, equal importance is to be given to the co-scholastics of the child and the scholastics. When we say scholastics, we are talking about, there are three parts to it. Everybody is able to see this? Yeah. There are three parts to it. You want, we can have this shifted. This scholastic, co-scholastic and co-curricular. When we assess a child, it is a 360 degrees assessment, everything together. Equal importance to the scholastics. When we say scholastics, it is about all the academics, the subjects which we generally study, English, Hindi, Maths, EBS or Science. In till class 5, in Poddar International CBSE, we study EBS, Environmental Studies, which is an equal mix of science and social science. And then we have social science, which starts from class 6 upwards, and then the third language. We'll come to those details. Now, scholastics and co-scholastics is all about your dance, music, yoga, all these activities. And when we say co-curricular, this also includes your behavior, your attitude. Everything is observed and assessed for the child, looking forward to a holistic development. That means when the report card is made, it will have all the gradings. It's no longer marks. In our times, I get a 91, I'm a topper. There is a 89 and a half who's come second. What happens then? The parent will say, "Uske aage tere nahi aaye. Why did you do this wrong? Why aren't you the topper when he can do it? Why haven't you done it?" The aim of the grading system introduced by CBSE is anybody who scores within that range of marks. It's no longer one person at the. It's not a pyramid now. It's a curve. You know, a bell curve. A bell curve will have a broader top at the top. That means more number of children can be in that bracket. Anybody who scores 91 to 100 is getting an A1 grade, is a topper. So definitely it's not one child. In every subject, it's an individual grading system. That reduces the stress more on the parents and consequently on the children as well. At least parents will not keep on nagging, you should get more, you should come first. There are no firsts there. There will be more number of children in all subjects A1, in all subjects A2, that is what is the grading system for, and it is also a standardization tool for the international curriculum. When we apply for any of the post-10th standard, they start asking, okay, what were your grades in the 9th and 10th? So it is a year-long assessment, which one makes it easier. You've learned it now, 2 days from now you will be assessed. Like that it goes on, and simultaneously when you keep assessing, it happens that the learning happens much deeper. So there are two parts to this scholastic assessment. One is called the formative assessment, the other is called as the summative assessment. Formative literally means formation. formative years, you know, when we say. So when we say formative assessment, it is assessment for learning. That is, during the course of learning, assessments which are done are called as formative assessments. That is, today I taught a chapter, maybe to a poem or something. 2 days later, I'll ask the child to recite the poem, or I might ask him to find out which is the best character or which are the two rhyming words in this poem, something like that. That is what is assessment during the course of learning throughout the class. Then there is something called the summative. Summative means some addition, total. This is a term-end examination. So there are 2 semesters in CBSE. The first semester beginning in April goes up to September. Term 2 or semester 2 begins in October, goes up to March. In each of these, there are 2 formatives and 1 summative. Don't start noting down, parents. Class 1 and 2 will not be writing any summatives. They will only be having assessments throughout the year. There is no examination till they come to class 3. Whenever the teacher wants, gives a worksheet, assessment is done without even telling the parent, because we don't want the parent to bother the child. And the child already is learning in the class, so automatically the learning has happened, the child has been assessed. You will not even come to know that assessments are going on. Each formative lasts for approximately 1.5 months. If you look at the calendar in the school diaries, it's not mentioned. There are no examinations for class 1 and 2. They do not have any summative exams. Formatives keep happening. The weightage, it's here, the slide is here for you to plan your child's future post third standard. You know, third standard only exams will come in. So, going back to it, what is a formative assessment? Each subject, approximately in 1.5 months, they will be assessed 5 times, approximately, depending on what are the topics covered. So, if there is a chapter on, four chapters done in a 1.5 months duration, the teacher might take a dictation, the teacher might do a role play. There are different tools of assessment, I'll be coming to that. So different types of assessments are there, minimum 4 to 5, duration of each is 1.5 months. Summative assessment anyway does not general instructions, nothing to worry about, there's not much homework given. But yes, you look at the last point there, there is a D grade. You know, the grading system for class up to class 3. The last grade given in class 2 is D grade, that is just average. You know, there is A, B, C, D. So it is generally, there is a range of that when we say there is no E1 and E2. But when we go to scholastics, actually speaking, third standard upwards, it is assessed on a 9-point scale. A, B, C, D, E, A1, A2, B1, B2, it goes on like that. Post-scholastics. Most interesting part for our children, what generally they look forward to. Life skills, work education, that is art and craft. We have visual and performing arts, so your child is going to have music and dance. That will be, I think some of you in the graduation ceremony of PJK would have seen a sample of our timetable. Yes? Yes? Yes. So if you've gone through the timetable, you would have seen that somewhere there is a period once a week of music with dance. It is not that either of it. It's just both the activities are given to the children. Alternatively, they do it. Class size in CBSE is 42. And a big relief for all the parents when they were thinking, how does it happen in CBSE? The teacher-student ratio is 1:1.5. We have something called a mother-teacher system. Since they are coming from PJK, where they are used to a single teacher throughout the day, so till second standard, there is one teacher who is called the mother-teacher. Again, the word itself is clear enough. She spends quality time with the children. So in a day, if I have 9 periods, she will be spending approximately 6 periods in the class with the child. To come to know them, to make them understand. So she handles English, EVS and mathematics for them. When it comes to Hindi, Marathi or other subjects, there are other teachers. Plus, This year, the management has also approved a co-teacher for the mother teacher, because she has to initially help the children. They don't know how to write diaries and all. So for class 1 and 2, we are going to have something called a co-teacher. In class 1, every teacher has a single co-teacher. In class 2 upwards, since the children grow up a bit, we have something called a float teacher, a co-teacher who is responsible for two classes together. But in class 1, every class mother teacher has a co-teacher there. So coming back to music and dance, this music learning or dance learning is not going to make them Bharatanatyam exponents or, you know, Michael Jackson's of tomorrow. It is just to identify their talents, their interests. You know, when the teacher does dance classes, we generally talk about only semi-classical or folk dance, like that. Even there is a theory part of it. So we are just trying to identify what are the interests of the child. When that goes to the parent, they can always take it forward as a, you know, making him or her joining a dance class or going for a vocal music. Similarly, we also offer them yoga and aerobics. Smaller classes, generally children below 6-7 years or 8 years below, generally we start with a very simple aerobics and yoga exercises. Again, the class, it goes parallel. One period, half the class will be doing yoga, the other half does aerobics, and vice versa next week. Again, to channelize their excess energy. Now they need to let out that extra energy which is there in that. There should be some kind of physical activity. So it happens that we give them yoga as well as aerobics. Co-scholastics also has something very, very important when we say attitudes and values. Again, it's a, you know, when we say assessments, it is not based on one teacher telling how is the child's attitude. Because at times, nobody in this world is unbiased. You know, at times it might happen that something somewhere has not gone correct between the teacher and the student. That remains in the mind. So this attitude and value assessment happens with respect to all the teachers handling that child in the class. There are generally 4 or 5, Hindi teacher, Marathi teacher, art and craft. Together they sit, we decide, okay, when we are giving them gradings, attitudes and values, it also includes how is the child at home. So when we have something called a journal. A teacher has one page for everybody, where they keep writing what are the behaviors observed in class. When the parents come for a PTM, we ask them their feedback, how is the child behaving at home. It is not to find faults with the child, but just to put them on the right track. Then we have co-curricular activities. There are two parts to co-curricular activities. This is how it is at the 9th, 10th level, the guidelines given by CBSE for that. We bring it down slowly to class 1 onwards so that they slowly get molded along those lines. Part A, we have to select any two. Again, there is no selection as such by the parent or the thing. In our school, we generally do literary and creative skills, and we do ICT. There is something computers also. If you looked at the timetable, when we said there is computers, we do not teach them computers per se to mug up what is RAM, ROM and all. It is applications of computer and really. So they will be asked to, you know, do maybe a paintbrush. As they go higher in class 9, I think we do C programming, 9 and 10. We go down to Visual Basics and we do different programs. In the lower classes, we do just how to use a paintbrush, how to open an email ID, things like that. So all that ICT program is to do projects in science or projects in other subjects. Application of computers is all assessed under that. Then there is a part B which talks about sports, indigenous sports, that is group sports, individual and group sports, and we do aerobics, yoga and aerobics, I mentioned. Every school is, CBSE gives us this freehold to do anything which is suitable to the level of the learners and the school infrastructure as well. So we do not do scouting and guiding as of now. We just take yoga and aerobics from here. Again, all these are graded. There are no marks to it. Teachers have a 5-point scale and they are converted into grades. Some of the, this is just an example, what are the tools of formative assessment? What type of, you know, Just like I said, all learners are different learners. So there are different tools which are used for assessing them. What is to be assessed and how it is to be assessed depends, one, on the class level of the learners. Second, on the topic which is being taught. These are some of the tools which one or the other will be used throughout the learning year, throughout the academic session. So if I am using a written test, maybe the question answers or the dictation words or something, everything is included in that. An MCQ test, that all that will be part of it. Again, there might be, as you go higher classes, there is a micro test, there is an open book test. There are different levels of that. There might be quiz in the class, debate in the class, and yes, one and two also. They do have. They have debates or discussions on anything which interests the lesson and interest relates to the topic which is being taught. There are a lot of group activities as well. Earlier days, any project, parents used to do it at home. And parents used to, ab kahan jayenge, saman kahan se milega, kya karenge. It's not like that. Now it is all the projects are to be done in school. Material, yes, some research work needs to be done at home. When they go to higher classes, we tell them, okay, this information you have to gather, they might use Google and other services. But in lower classes, we'll just tell them, okay, tomorrow you need to bring these pictures and all. Again, the question is, ek din pehle bata diya, raat ko kaun si dukaan khuli, I come back at 10 o'clock, how do I get the material? So generally, at the beginning of the term, some material you've already got it in the school stationery, some crayons, some clay and all. At the beginning of the term, we give them the term requirement, whether it is activity, art and craft or anything. There is a set term requirement which is given. Looking into the art and craft book and the syllabus, what is to be covered, generally they do. There is also topic wise, subject related activities. Maybe they have to prepare, I know they've studied something about wheel. They need to make a wheel in class. So they need certain things to be brought at home. The wheel can be made out of maybe molding clay, or at times they need to bring wool pieces, small match sticks and all. Generally, this is informed to them at least a week in advance, because it all depends on the lesson plan. Again, when we say assessments are being done, you do not get a diary note. How do you know that assessment is going to happen? Frequently, the diary will be written, revise this chapter, revise. 3-4 times if the homework says revise, you will know that assessment is about to happen or it's in the course. Because when you are doing assessment, something like a role play or an individual assessment like recitation, obviously 42 cannot be covered in a 30-minute period. It's going to be a week-long assessment. Teacher will assess them in 3-4 days, 10 children in one period, something like that. So assessments happen. At times, the only thing you need to do at your end is see that your child is in school. Again, the question is, what if my child is sick? All the oral assessments which are being done, we continue for 1.5 months. So child is absent on Monday, Tuesday, somewhere the child will come. Written assessment, which is, you know, like a board exam, it's on a particular date or anything, and if the child misses, even in that case, if it's a medical case and it is within the 7 days, we do the redo the written assessment. But that doesn't mean you go on a Euro trip, because I've had this, I'm speaking from experience, 10 days, 15 days holiday, so and so getting married, mami ki shadi, kisi ki shadi, I keep getting applications like that. And then what happens there, the child has been absent for the 10 days, the learning has not happened, how do I assess? See, that's not fair for us to assess a child, because the child was absent for 10 days when the teacher had taught in the class, he was not there. So how can I assess that child? There is no point giving a worksheet and the child just doesn't fill it up, doesn't write.